Well, good morning, church. I hope that you have come ready. I love that. Somebody applaud when we get started. I like that. That's all good. Hey, we're glad that you're here. We're going to start the service a little differently today. We are going to have Lord's Supper today, and I encourage you just to be thinking about where you've been this past week, these past months, where you stand with the Lord. We're going to be talking about that today. We're going to have the Lord's Supper toward the end of the service. We're going to have an invitation before the Lord's Supper. So if you want to just kind of spend some time with the Lord and kind of examine your own self before you come to the Lord's table, I encourage you to do so. If you are a first-time guest with us today, let me kind of talk about that for a minute. If you're a guest with us in general today, we want to welcome you to partake of the Lord's Supper as well. If you're a believer, if you're a Christian, we encourage you to come and partake. So it's an open communion. Also, if you are a first-time guest, I encourage you to fill out the guest information section in your bulletin and drop it in the offering plate at the end of the service so we could kind of recognize you and thank you for being here. We want to welcome you. And if I haven't met you, I'd love to meet you after the service and love to meet you right after at the Welcome Center. We've got a gift for you as well, so make sure you do that. Also, you see in your bulletin there's a big orange form for Vacation Bible School registration. So if parents, you want to register your kids for Vacation Bible School, you can go ahead and do that. You can drop that in the offering plate at the end of the service as well, or just give it to the Welcome Center desk at the end of the service. So I encourage you today to just really be reflective and to think about what God has been doing in your life, maybe some things, maybe some areas of your life where maybe you need to improve, maybe some areas in your life where you need to kind of give back to the Lord that you've kind of taken more control of. This is what the Lord's table is all about. So I want to stand and pray, and we're going to just have a time of worship, and we're going to go to the Lord's table today. God, we thank you. We're eternally grateful for this sacrificial act that you did for us on the cross. And Lord, as we are preparing our hearts and our minds to come to your table, I pray, Lord, that as David prayed, that, Lord, you will search us and try us. In any of those areas of our life where maybe we've been offensive to you, God, you'll reveal that to us today. And God, that you'll help us rid ourselves of that in our lives, and so that we could live for you, that we could be beacons of light for you, for your kingdom work. So God, as we worship you today, as we sing about you, as we open your word and hear about you, I pray, God, that you will open up our hearts fresh and anew today. Lord, I don't want today's service to just be another routine deal at church. I don't want our service to be just another thing that we do. God, I pray that these next moments that we're together will be life-changing, will be life-altering. That God, we won't leave here today the same as what we came in. So God, will you speak to our hearts? Will you minister to our souls today? God, will you use everything that's happening today for your glory and for your honor? And I pray this in your name.
Only you, Lord. Guys, as we are getting ready to take the Lord's Supper later in the service, let's just use this next song to really focus our attention on why we observe the Lord's Supper. We are observing this to remember the sacrifice that Jesus made for us.
How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that He should give His only Son to make a wretch His treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turns His face away, as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory. Behold the man upon His shoulders, ashamed I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held Him there until it was a in Jesus Christ, His death and resurrection. Why should I gain from His reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, His word have paid my ransom. Why should I gain from His reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, His words have paid. But this I know with all my heart, His words have paid my ransom.
Lord Jesus, thank You so much for the sacrifice that You made for us. And Lord, I pray that as we sit at Your table, as we come to Your table, Lord, that we would not come in vain, that we would not come unworthy. And there's no reason any of us should not come. We know that we are unworthy in and of ourselves, but we also know that there's provision for forgiveness in Christ. There's provision of grace. And I pray that right now, Lord, we would ask for forgiveness of our sins. Lord, that we would rely on Your grace. And Lord, as Your Holy Spirit is speaking to us now, I pray that Your Spirit would bring to mind things that we may not even be thinking of that we need to confess to you right now. And Lord, that we would take this time leading up to the Lord's Supper to prepare our hearts to come before you and worship you for the sacrifice that you made for us. You paid it all. And so, Lord, we give you the thanks and the praise for all of this. And we pray for Pastor David, God, that you would shine through him as he preaches this morning. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Jared. Thank you, church. Before we start, I just want to thank all the folks who showed up yesterday to cut trees in our front yard. And a lot of trees had to go down, but we thank you for all those who helped cut trees. And for those who kind of, as you see, it's a little cooler in here than it was this time last Sunday, which is kind of nice. So thanks for all those who helped get that fixed. And another great piece of news, most of you all know that we as a church support financially the FCA program over at Leoma School that meets every Thursday morning. We kind of supply some good old spiritual Mountain Dew and Pepsi and chocolate-covered donuts for them every morning to make those kids more spiritual. And listen, it worked. This past Thursday, last FCA of the year, four students accepted Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. Amen? Isn't that awesome? It's good stuff. So be in prayer for them and be in prayer for them to kind of be connected to a local church that they can be discipled. And I just wanted to let you know that. Turn your Bibles with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 10 this morning. We're obviously going to come to the table. We're going to come to the Lord's table. And again, some of you all have been here. You've done this before. Some of you maybe who are new for us, maybe this is your first time coming to the Lord's table here at our church. We don't do this every single Sunday because I think sometimes just in our humanity, it kind of becomes a rote memorization thing that you just kind of do as a routine, and it loses its meaning. We also don't just do it once a year. We do it five or six times a year that we can really focus in on the sacredness of the moment, the specialty of what Jesus Christ did for us on the cross, the incredible magnitude of what that means for us as Christians. I want to read from 1 Corinthians chapter 10. Verses 14 through 22. Most of you all realize that 1 Corinthians 11 talks a lot about the Lord's Supper. This is a little bit before that because Paul really had a lot of work to do with the church at Corinth. And here's what he said to him in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 14. He says, "Therefore, my dear friends, flee from idolatry. I speak to sensible people." I said this to the first service. I hope I'm speaking to sensible people today. So I got three amens. Okay, I'm a little concerned. But Paul says, "I speak to sensible people. Judge for yourselves what I say. Is not the cup of thanksgiving for which we give thanks a participation in the blood of Christ? It is not the bread that we break a participation in the body of Christ? Because there is one loaf, we who are many are one body, for we all share the one loaf." Verse 18, "Consider the people of Israel. Do not those who eat the sacrifices participate in the altar? Do I mean that food sacrificed to an altar is anything or that an idol is anything? No, but the sacrifices of pagans are offered to demons, not to God. And I do not want to be participants with demons." Amen. "You cannot drink the cup of the Lord and the cup of demons too. You cannot have a part in both the Lord's table and the table of demons." Verse 22, "Are we trying to arouse the Lord's jealousy? Are we stronger than he?" A lot of rhetorical questions in there from Paul. No, we're not stronger than Jesus Christ. No, we're not trying to arouse the Lord's anger, but maybe are we? Maybe unintentionally, are we arousing the Lord's anger? So today we come to the table. We were coming to the Lord's table. I remember growing up in my home, I had two brothers and a sister and family of six. And I remember, like, you know, especially when I was like 12, 13, 14, I was growing. And I mean, I loved to eat. And when I heard my mom say, "Dinner's ready, come to the table," right? I mean, you didn't have to ask me twice. I mean, I was sprinting. I mean, with a family of six and a fixed income, and we just had to kind of, I mean, I was there. I was counting how many, okay, there's six biscuits. Okay, we each get one. I was doing all the math. That's how I learned my math, right? I was, you know, if we had 12 popsicles, I got two of them. I knew that. I mean, I just knew how that worked. And so, you know, when Mom said, come to the table, that was a special time in our family. I don't know what it was for you growing up. For us, it was a time where we could not only get together and just eat, which I enjoyed, but it was also a time for us as a family to come together, to fellowship, to talk about maybe the day that just happened to us, or maybe talk about what was happening in the days to come. We had a great time of fellowship, and this passage here is talking about coming to the Lord's table. And Jesus is saying to us today, hey, I want you to come to my table. I want you to come to my table. And, you know, back in those days when I was growing up, there were some certain things that you had to bring to the table, right? And as we're talking about the Lord's Supper today, I'm going to talk about today several things that we need to bring to the table, okay? So maybe you just thought, I thought I was just showing up for church. I thought I was just doing my thing. Just going. No, you have to bring some stuff to the table, okay? And so let's start. In your notes, if you want to follow along, the first one here is before we sit down to a meal, we need clean hands, right? Give us clean hands, right? Remember that old song? It's a great song. And I didn't go to my mom's table now, by the way, with just dirty hands, right? Wash your hands, boy. You know, I mean, that's what happened, Bubba, right? That's what happened in your house, right? I mean, that's what happened. You washed your hands. You were out there working, and you washed your hands. And so, in a sense, folks, when we come to the Lord's table, we need to wash up as well. In fact, in 1 Corinthians 11, Paul goes on and talks a little bit more about the Lord's Supper, and he says that we ought to examine our lives before receiving the Lord's Supper. What does that look like? We need to examine our lives. I mean, some of us, maybe we need to confess some things. Maybe some of us need to reconcile with some people. Maybe some of us need to be cleaned up in some areas. And that's what we're supposed to do before we come to the Lord's table. If not, maybe you don't need to receive the Lord's table. Growing up with two brothers, I had an older brother and a younger brother, and I always, you know, got picked on by my older brother and always beat up my younger brother. That's how it worked, huh? That's what middle child's all about, right? That's how it works. So there were days, there were moments in our lives where, you know, me and especially Scott, my younger brother, we'd be in a fight, we'd be doing something, and Mom would do what? She would send us to bed without supper. That ever happened to y'all? And the reason of that was that was a punishment. You don't have the privilege today, David, to sit down at dinner with us and have food. You're gonna, because you've been bad. And so you have to go to your room without supper. And I hated those days. It didn't happen very often, but when it happened, it was meaningful to me. And so here in coming to the Lord's table, it's important for us to examine ourselves. How have we been? What have we been doing? I mean, and listen, this is how cool Jesus is. Jesus is one who forgives. He's one who understands that you haven't done everything quite right. You can come to him with remorse, and you can come to him with repentance, and he still has an invitation to his table. And I know some of you may be so burdened with maybe what's been going on this week, this month, these last, you know, few weeks or whatever in your life, and maybe you're just so overtaken by that. Maybe when the tray is passed by you, maybe you pass it. And I respect that. But listen, I want you to understand that we're going to have an opportunity before we come to the Lord's table today to get that right. Because listen, nobody in this room is worthy. Nobody. I don't care how good you are. None of us are worthy for this. But we're eligible. If we're believers in Jesus Christ, if we've turned our life over to him, we're eligible. And he invites us and he authorizes us to come to his table. So maybe some of you need to wash up. Here's two. Here's a second one. You know, before we come to the table, we need to have a good appetite, right? I mean, think about that for just a minute. I mean, if I were to invite you over to my house tonight at, let's say, 7 o'clock, and I want you to come, and we're going to have a big dinner, I'm going to fix dinner for you, and you're going to come, you probably wouldn't just at 6 o'clock head over to Dunkin' Donuts and get a half dozen of chocolate cream-filled donuts with several, you know, chocolate latte, you know, chasers, right? And then go by Wendy's and get a triple burger and a fry and a Coke and maybe chase that down with a Frosty and then show up at my house, right? Because you wouldn't be hungry. You wouldn't have an appetite for what the good. I was going to get you steak too. I was going to have steak and potatoes and salad, and I was going to have some. I was going to have some good stuff, right? But see, you'd filled up with junk. You wouldn't be able to have an appetite for what the good stuff I was going to offer you. Here's what Paul says in verse 21. Listen to what he says in verse 21 that I just read. You can't drink the cup of the Lord and the cup of demons too. You see that? You can't do that. You can't have it both ways. You can't have a part in both the Lord's table and the table of demons. And so I want you to understand that the Lord offers us a substantive meal here. I mean, I realize that this piece of bread and this small cup of juice is not going to fill you up physically, but it will fill you up spiritually. And I'm just wondering in this process that what are we filling ourselves up with? I mean, if we fill ourselves up with the junk food of the world, the junk food of sin, we're never going to have an appetite to be at the banquet table that God sets for us. And I just wonder how many of us just kind of get caught up in just feeding ourselves the things of the world. And maybe you need to do what Psalm 34:8 says. Maybe we need to taste and see that the Lord is good. Maybe we need to taste and see what it means to kind of just soak in God and soak in His Word. We need to taste that. I mean, listen, I understand we're in the world, but we don't have to be of it. We're exposed to a very sinful, dark place, but we can resist the temptation. We can. And so if you want an appetite for God, maybe you need to think about what things you're feeding on throughout the week. Are you feeding on these temporal things, these things that aren't eternal, these things that have no purpose and no meaning? Are you looking at things below as opposed to things that are above? Jesus promises us this. He says this. He says, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, and what? They will be filled. What does he mean by that? Filled by what? Well, I think a lot of people live their lives empty. You ever had that day where you kind of had breakfast and lunch and really all you've had is a couple of, you know, soda pops and maybe a couple of Twinkies and a brownie and a piece of cake for lunch? And then about 2 o'clock, you kind of have that sugar coma. You know what I'm talking about? And you're not good for anything. You're worthless, right? And this is kind of what happens to us spiritually. We just kind of feed on the world and we feed on things that have no eternal value. And we go by day without really much purpose or out without much meaning. And at the end of the day, we kind of realize, you know, what have we really done here today? Do I have any purpose? And you're starving spiritually. Let me just kind of ask you, just personally, you don't have to answer this question, but think about it. Has every day in this past 7 days, every one of those days, did you feast on God's word? Every one of those days, have you taken 15 minutes a day and just communed with God and talked to Him through prayer? If not, you're spiritually starving. And so I encourage you not to feast on the things of the world and come to the Lord's table today with an appetite for more of Him, for an appetite of, God, I want to be more like You. It's like the old song, I want to know You. I want to know You more. I want to feel You, God. I want to know You. I want to know You're in my life. That's the appetite we're supposed to come to the Lord's table with. Here's number three. When we're dining at the Lord's table, listen, we need to enjoy the moment. Guys, we're going 180 all the time. I'm guilty. Leon and I, when we first started dating in college at East Tennessee State University, there was a restaurant on campus called the Eat and Run. That was the name of it, Eat and Run. We had other names for it that I won't mention here in church, but because the food wasn't really that great. But that's literally what people would do. They would between classes, you would just whip in there, get a cheeseburger, wolf it down, and then go to the next class. That's what you did. It was Eat and Run. And it was interesting that's what I did until I met Leanne, and so we started kind of hanging out in the Eat and Run because we were in love. And all of a sudden, you know, we were sitting down and we weren't running. We were just eating and talking and staring in each other's eyes, right? Because what? Because there was something that was meaningful and purposeful going on. 27 years later, it's still going. Amen. You know? Amen. That's a marriage sermon for another day. But listen, I want you to understand this. I even read somewhere this week where places like McDonald's and Burger King, they make their chairs uncomfortable because they don't want you to stay very long. You folks at Hardee's, sorry, I know you like to go to Hardee's and stay. Kenny, I know you like to go to Hardee's and stay, brother. But I mean, really, that's why it's called fast food. They want you to buy food, eat it, and get out, and let the next customer come in and buy food, eat it, and get out. That's what they want to do. That's why they make it that way. And I just think we're guilty of that in our spiritual lives. We're guilty of that because I think we just kind of whip into church, roll in here on two wheels, you know, get out, you know, get your clothes disheveled and get in here and just, you know, and then you're already thinking about what's next. And maybe what we need to do is maybe we need to slow down. And maybe we need to kind of, as we come to the Lord's table today, just listen, just savor the moment. Maybe we need to take some time to just linger, to reflect, to remember. And I have to admit, as a pastor, I've done this before. I've just kind of whisked through the Lord's Supper. I don't want to do that today. I don't want to do that ever. Because this is such an incredible moment of worship. It should be the center of our worship today. We get to worship Jesus Christ and what he did for us on the cross, which I think leads to the next one I want to kind of camp out on for a minute. And this is what we need to bring to the table. Harmony. Harmony is important at the table of the Lord. You know, you've probably been at that family. You know, you've been to that family outing where you're eating together with family, maybe extended family members, and everybody's excited to get there, and they sit down, and then Uncle George or Grandma Sue or Sister Susie or Brother Joe starts talking about something that everybody disagrees with. You ever been there? You know, they start bringing up political things or sport things or educational things or worldview things, and then all of a sudden there's tension. You've been there? And all of a sudden the meal's not very enjoyable, and you just like, when can we? I've got something to go to. I've got to go, right? That's what we're doing. And that's what happens sometimes at church, sadly. And we do this. And listen, church, I want you to understand. I understand we have a big congregation here. We can't expect everybody to have the same views on everything. We're different people, and that's okay. But I want you to understand this. We're expected to get along. Amidst all of our differences in all kinds of different views on things, we are expected to get along. A lost world is watching. Amen. When all they see you do is bicker with each other and fight with each other, they want no part of that. They don't want to be there. They're not back there saying, well, that Leoma Baptist Church, they fight with each other. I just love them. They just fight and bicker all the time. Nobody says that. Nobody. In fact, quite the opposite happens. It's when we're unified. It's when we have this big conglomeration of people from all different walks of life, all different backgrounds, some from here, some not from here, different races, different ethnicities, different socioeconomic backgrounds, and somehow we're all getting along. That is incredible to a lost world. It's incredible. So there's just no room for divisiveness at the Lord's table. Look what Paul said in verse 17. Paul makes a point of saying, we are one body. We partake of one loaf. So conflict and tension and disharmony, it could all ruin all of that. So we just, there's no room for divisiveness. So I just want to, again, I just want to kind of hang out here for a minute, okay? Because this is a real issue in most churches across the country. And I think if Leoma Baptist Church wants to have an impact in this world, people outside of our church are going to have to see the reality of our faith lived out in our lives. And one of the ways you do that is you live with Christian virtues in your life everywhere you go. And one of, I think, the greatest, most observable Christian virtues is harmony. That you can be harmonious with each other. Here's how Paul said it in Galatians 5:15. He says, if you bite and devour one another, beware lest you be consumed by one another. Who wants that, right? Harmony is critical, folks. Harmony is just critical for our whole mission and focus of a church. We've got to be harmonious. And maybe you're thinking, well, what's harmony exactly? Well, I'm not going to be Jared because he's our music guy, but I know he knows music really well. But let me use a music analogy. For you to understand harmony, you really fully have to understand melody, right? And so what is melody, for those of you who are not musical, it's just kind of one note played after another note that kind of sets the tune for the song. That's the easy part of the song. If you know a song and you hum that song, you're humming the melody of the song. Okay, it's the easy part. Melody, harmony is also similar. Harmony is also a group of notes that's kind of behind or beneath or around the melody. And it brings fullness. It brings texture. It brings a richness to the melody. Harmony supports the melody. And I want you to understand this. Harmony in the church, harmony in the body of Christ, when we're all harmonious, when we're behind, beneath, and around the vision and direction of the church, that's unity. That's harmony. There's a singleness of mind. There's an enhancing and a deepening of the beauty of the life and the body of Christ when that happens. So if we're in harmony, we're all striving to fulfill that goal. Yes, we're going to be different. We're all over the board. Some of you are Redskins fans. Some of you are Cowboys fans. Some of you love Alabama, bless your heart. Some of you love Tennessee, amen, right? And that's okay. It's okay. Some of you are Democrats. Some of you are Republicans. Some of you are independent. It's okay. Are we unified in Christ? Some of you have different political views. Some of you have different views on education. Some of you have different views on all kinds of things. Can we be unified in Christ? Can that be our focus? Here's how Paul said it. Paul said in 1 Corinthians 12, 5 and 6, he said, there are differences of ministries, but the same Lord. And there are diversities of activities, but it is the same God who works all in all. Some of you guys, listen, I'll just talk to them in a minute. I think some of you guys are nuts for getting up early in the morning in the middle of the winter and sitting in a tree hunting a deer. I just think that's crazy. But you all love it. So some of y'all look at me and say, dude, you're getting on a bicycle and riding across the state of Tennessee for 500 miles. You're an idiot. And that's okay. We can be okay with those differences, right? But we can have unity in Jesus Christ. So harmony is unity of thought, and it's unity of feeling. It's not a loss of individualism. We can all be individuals. I love that about our church. We have a lot of different individuals in our church, amen? Amen. That's great. That's what makes church exciting. I would hate for everybody to go, I love Jesus, I love the Lord, we love Pastor David. I don't want that. That'd be a bunch of robots. I love that we have diversity. It's great. Paul, let's be unified in the Lord. Let's have harmony. You know what hinders harmony? Legalism. You know what legalism is? Legalism is taking a commandment or opinion of men and teaching or promoting it as if it's a doctrine of God. That's what legalism is. And so all of a sudden, the words of men are equal to the words of God. Not true. And so we need to understand, we're not going to be alike in this congregation. In fact, we are very different. In fact, God intended for all of us not to be alike. Because he knew if he can get a group of people at Leoma Baptist Church together that are from all kind of different walks of life and they can be unified, he can change the world. We need harmony before we come to the table. Here's another thing that breaks up harmony, criticism. We're all critics, aren't we? Here's what the Bible says about that. Paul says in Romans 14, 13, he says, therefore, let us not judge one another anymore, but rather resolve this, not to put a stumbling block or a cause to fall in our brother's way. Here's what Jesus said about criticism in Luke chapter 6, verse 41. He says, and why do you look at the speck in your brother's eye, but do not perceive the plank in your own eye? Or how do you say to your brother, brother, let me remove the speck that is in your eye, when you yourself do not see the plank that is in your own eye? Hypocrite, he says, first remove the plank from your own eye, and then you will see clearly to remove the speck that is in your brother's eye. Yeah, it's okay. I tell you know, our deacons and our staff and our leadership, I tell them I need that friend that'll stab me in the front. I need some people like that in my life, right? I need people that will look at me face to face and say, brother, you're wrong. But I know they'll do that in love. We have that, but we can't be critical. It hinders harmony. There's lots of other things that hinder harmony. Well, how do you achieve harmony? I mean, if we're going to come to the Lord's table in harmony, how do you achieve that? Well, we let our focus be Jesus. Let me say that again. We let our focus be Jesus and Him alone. We follow what Colossians 1, 17 and 18 says. It says, and He is before all things, and in Him all things consist, and He is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things He may have the preeminence. He's the focus. So don't focus on me. Don't focus on your pastor. Don't focus on your youth pastor. Don't focus on what kind of music we have here. Don't focus on what style of the building of the church. Don't focus on people who aren't living in Christ. Focus on Christ. That's how we have harmony. Focus on the body of Christ. Focus on the Great Commission harmoniously. That's what we do. Paul said it this way, 1 Corinthians 2:2. I love this. Paul just says it straight. I love it. I'm just going to shoot you straight like Paul did. For I determined not to know anything among you. In other words, Paul was saying, I don't care what team you like. I don't care your political affiliation. I don't care where you come from. I don't care what color your skin is. I don't care. He says, I determined not to know anything among you except Jesus Christ and Him crucified. That's it. If we could agree on that, we can change the world. Our church can make a difference. So we've got to keep our spirit humble and yielded. We got to keep our hearts tender. Did you hear that? Let me just say that again. Let me just kind of read a verse that kind of, I don't want you to just think that I'm just giving Pastor David's opinions up here. Yeah, we need to be tender. In fact, Romans 12:10, Paul says, be kindly affectionate to one another with brotherly love. And in honor, giving preference to one another. Did you hear that? It's not about you. It's not about how you feel on an issue or a topic or a deal or a thing. It's we're supposed to be kindly affectionate to one another with brotherly love, in honor, giving preference to one another. Does that mean we can never disagree with Jeff? I can disagree with you. I could say, Jeff, brother, I love you. I disagree with that. Let's talk about it. And I can do it in love, and I can do it in grace. And he could buy my lunch in the process. Or I may buy his, right? And it's okay to have conversation. In fact, I love conversation like that. I say to small group leaders all the time, I say one of the best things you can hear in your small group is, you know, I kind of disagree with this. Let me tell you why. That's okay. That's fodder for great discussion, as long as you do it kindly and affectionately toward one another with brotherly love. I'm meeting so many people nowadays who are just ready to fight. They don't care what it's about. They'll fight about whether, you know, which high school is better, Loretta or Lawrence County. It's fight. You know, I mean, they're ready to fight over everything, every political view, every educational view, everything that's going on in the current events of the world. They're ready to fight over it. What happened to Romans 12:10? What happened to harmony? Folks, if we're going to make an impact in this world and make a difference in this world, we've got to be kindly affectionate toward one another. Amen by myself, again. I'm hanging out there. I know. Let me just read one more. We got to keep that unity. The Holy Spirit helps us with that. Listen to what Paul said in Ephesians 4, 1 through 3. He says, I, therefore, the prisoner of the Lord. I love how he refers to himself as a prisoner of the Lord. He says, I beseech you to walk worthy of the calling which we were called, with all lowliness and gentleness, with long suffering. Did you hear that? Some of you are going to have to long suffer with me. And I'm going to have to long suffer with you. But I'm going to do it. Why? Well, because the next sentence says, bearing with one another in love. Bearing with one another in love, endeavoring, that's a relentless, continual, never-ending working, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. We've got to work at it, church. Every single day, we've got to work at it. But see what happens if we let it slide, we let it fly. We'll be at home this afternoon eating. Somebody will bring up something. Well, that's what that church is doing. I can't believe they're doing that. They're stupid people. And we just kind of let that stuff fly. And other people hear that and they think there's no harmony there. You know? We've got to be harmonious. We've got to be harmonious in our church. We've got to remind ourselves that if you're a believer, that the Holy Spirit lives in every born-again believer. How many Christians have the Holy Spirit in them? All of them. So we need to get together and be harmonious. Here's how A.W. Tozer said it. For those of you who are musically minded, you might appreciate this. He said, has it ever occurred to you that 100 pianos, all tuned to the same tuning fork, are automatically tuned to each other? They are of one accord by being tuned not to each other, but to another standard to which each one must individually bow. So 100 worshipers meeting together, each one looking to Jesus, are in heart nearer to each other than they could possibly be were they to become unity conscious and turn their eyes away from God to strive for closer fellowship. Folks, we've got to be unified under one thing, and that one thing is Jesus Christ. Amen. Number five on this, if you're wanting to know what to bring to the table, we need to be grateful for this meal. We need to come with gratitude. We need to come with a thankful heart. I think about in the Old Testament when God supplied the Jewish people this manna, this miraculous food from heaven. And what'd they do? They complained. Manna, again? No cheeseburgers? God, I mean, can you have cheeseburgers raining from heaven? That'd be great. Cake, how about some cake? With icing on it this time, you know? I mean, they were complaining the whole time, and I want you to think about that. Sometimes we do that at church, right? We come and we just kind of come with not a grateful heart, but with more of a critical heart. And I want you to understand that we need to appreciate this meal on several levels. There's one level, like I think about like Mark and Beverly Peters, who are on our Lord's Supper team, and they were here very early this morning preparing all of this. I think about Norma Williams, who made all of the bread that we're going to take. I think about all the deacons who will be here in just a few minutes to kind of serve all of you, the Lord's disciples. We need to be thankful for those people. But most importantly, we need to think about what this meal cost our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We need to think about the magnitude of what he did for us. We need to be grateful. We need to have a spirit of gratitude as we come to the table. And lastly, we need to come to God's table with loyalty. Loyalty. If your family had a restaurant here in the Lawrence County area, I would pretty much guess that you would go to that restaurant periodically, and you would go and you would support that business, and you would go and you would eat there, and you would enjoy it. You would be loyal to your family. And here Paul is talking about in the scripture in 1 Corinthians 10, he's talking about how people try to eat at the devil's table and at the Lord's table all at the same time. And Paul's trying to let the Corinthians know, here, look, God's a jealous God. He wants all of you. He doesn't want some of you. He wants all of you all the time. He demands undivided loyalty. And the Christians here in Corinth were kind of toying with this idea of going back to some of their, idolatry practices and on their former lives. And they, and I know we don't see that a lot today. We don't see a lot of this overt pagan, idol worship in our world today. But you know what? I see idol worship every day. Because anytime you put something above Jesus Christ, you're worshiping an idol. And here the scripture says, folks, you can't come to the Lord's table And then this afternoon sit at the demon's table. This is serious. I'll say it this way. You'll never hear a pastor say this. I don't want you to commit to Jesus. Because if you commit, you're in charge. You'll say, yeah, God, I'll give you Sundays. I'll give you 10 to 12 on Sundays. I might give you a Wednesday night. The rest of my life is mine. I'm going to do with it what I want. You've committed. I don't want you to commit to Jesus. I want you to surrender to Jesus. Because then he's in charge. Because then you said, I surrender everything. My life, my flaws, my successes, my skills, my talents, my resources, my money, my family, my spouse, everything. It's yours. I'm not in charge anymore. I'm not in control anymore. God, I surrender it all to you. And that's how God wants us. Well, that's a lot, Pastor Dave. Yes, it's everything, but he gives everything. And he's a God of everything. He's a God who can do miraculously, immeasurably more than you can think or imagine in your life by the power of Christ that's in you. So I guess just a few questions before we come to an invitation. And I'm going to go ahead and ask Jared and the band to come. But here's a couple of questions I just want you to think about. Questions that will help you understand what you're bringing to the table today. Questions that will help you kind of clue into what it means to participate in the table of the Lord today. Because guys, listen, I don't ever want to take this lightly. So let me just ask you a few questions. Number one, have you washed up? Are you where you need to be spiritually today? Are there some areas in your life where maybe you just need to confess? Are there some areas in your life where you need to kind of repent of what's been going on? How's your appetite today? What have you been feeding on throughout this week, throughout this last month? What are the things that are going into your brain, into your eyes, into your body? What are the things that you've been feeding on that are not of the Lord? Are you hungry for God today? Maybe you just need to slow down. Maybe you're just too rushed. Maybe today is just a day for you to be still and not to rush, not be in a hurry. Is there someone here that you're not harmonious with? Is there somebody, maybe it's a spouse, maybe it's a kid, maybe it's a brother or sister in Christ here in this church that you just kind of say, I don't like them. And you're kind of living that. You need to get that right. Maybe I could ask you where your loyalties lie today. Maybe I could ask you, what are you thankful for today? Are you truly loyal to God? And so I just want us, before we come to the Lord's table, we're going to have an invitation. I'm just going to tell you, listen, if you're here today and you need to know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, what a great day for that. Anthony and Randy and I will be down here. If you want to talk to one of our pastors, we'd love to just chat with you. We'll spend the afternoon with you if you need to. We'll just talk with you, and we'll just share with you in God's Word what it means to become a Christian, what it means to surrender your life to Jesus Christ. Maybe that's what you need to do today. Maybe you're a Christian here today, and maybe some of those things we talked about, these preparations of coming to the Lord's table, have really gripped you. There's conviction in your life. Maybe there's a disharmony moment in your life with maybe a spouse or a kid or a friend. Maybe you're not loyal to him. Maybe your appetites, your hunger is for things not of the Lord. Maybe there's just a sin. Maybe there's a besetting sin that just kind of keeps creeping into your life that you just need to kind of say, God, no more. I'm giving that to you. I would just imagine in a crowd this size, there's probably many Christians here that probably one of those areas, we probably need to be at the altar today, right? I know I do. So you stand with me and pray. God, before we come to your table, we want to wash up. We want to make sure, God, that we are where we need to be with you. And God, I'm just asking that today, people all across this room, young and old, whatever things they've been dealing with in their life, Lord, that maybe before they come to the Lord's table and before we kind of linger and reflect and remember what you did for us on the cross, that God, we'll examine ourselves and we'll come to you, surrender to you, holy to you. God, I know you're a God of forgiveness. I know that in my life this week there's been things that I'm not proud of. So God, just personally, forgive me for those areas that I failed you miserably. So God, as we sing, I just ask that, Lord, people all over the room, that God, you'll speak to their heart very personally, very individually. And God, there'll be a response to you. Harmony will be built. Loyalty will be restored. A cleansing will happen in our lives so we can come to your table prepared, ready to remember. God, we love you, and I pray this in your name. Amen. Come.